Hello dear students, welcome to EPG Paathshala. I am Dr. Surinder Kaur, Professor, Khalsa College of Education, Ranjit Avenue, Amritsar. Well students, today we will discuss about the topic Concept and Approaches to Educational Administration, Management and Governance. The objectives of the topic are explain the meaning or concept of educational administration, management and governance. Illustrate the common features of educational administration. Discuss the functions of educational administration. Explain the meaning of educational management and governance. And elaborate the different approaches of educational administration, management and governance. Educational administration is a process that includes the combined operation for maintaining good working conditions. It is a process of utilizing appropriate material in such a way to promote effectively the development of human qualities. It includes all those techniques and procedures employed in operating the educational organization in accordance with established policies. It is the totality of resources which makes it effective for accomplishing the purpose of an enterprise. Educational administration includes certain functions like planning, organizing, financing, directing, supervising, inspecting, and evaluation. It is also concerned with elements like setting up of goals of education, review, feedback, and innovation. Now let us discuss how different educationists have defined the meaning of educational administration. According to Graham Balfour, educational administration enables the pupils to receive the right education from the right teachers at a cost within the means of the state under conditions which will enable the pupils to profit by their training. According to R. Mott, educational administration is the influencing of one group of human beings, the pupils, to grow towards defined objectives utilizing a second group of human beings, the teachers, as an agent and operating in a setting of a third group of public. Variously concerned both with objecting and with means used to achieve them. According to National Society for the Study of Education, educational administration is a social statesmanship which guides educational activities, plan programs and facilities and provides leadership in a long-term but broad social perspective. Stephen describes educational administration as a process concerned with creating, maintaining, stimulating and unifying the energies within an educational institution towards realization of predetermined objectives. After defining meaning of educational administration, now let's discuss about the features of educational administration. The common features of educational administration are, first of all, for the fulfillment of the goals of an organization, administrators should involve all the people of that organization for the attainment of predetermined goals. Second is providing suitable conditions for work and raising the morale of the workers on the job. There should be provision for innovations, changes, and development in one's organization. It is humanistic and reorganizer in its approach. Its major objective is to build the personality of individual, his needs and his quest for perfection is glorified. It enables the individuals to understand that crime is evil. It is not merely the political philosophy, but psychology, ethics, sociology, and history, which determine the educational processes or procedures. Educational administration proceeds by taking individual as a unit. Educational administration is more concerned with the inner development of human personality. Educational administration tries to make an individual a moral and cultural person. Educational administration believes in experimentation. Now, principles of educational administration. First of all, we will discuss principle of sharing responsibility. John Dewey, the famous American philosopher, has defined democracy as a sharing of experiences. A democratic head shares his responsibility with others and believes in the decentralization of powers. It enables the leader and the followers to have good mental health. Second is principle of equality. Democracy demands equality of opportunity to all. All are equal in the eyes of law. A democratic head does not consider himself aloof from others. He feels as he was one social being in an inseparable unity of same social structure. Second is principle of freedom. It is one of the unique principles of democracy. The democratic head gives full freedom to the staff so that they may work according to their will. Next is principle of cooperation. The running of a school is not one man's job. It needs combination of many hands. Every member of the school should fully cooperate with the colleagues and with the head of the institution. Next, that is the principle of justice. Democratic administration demands full justice on the part of the headmaster of the school. The democratic administration will be successful only if the headmaster does justice to one and all. In such an environment, all are treated alike and get due importance. Next is principle of recognition of individual worth. In democratic administration, the head shows equality to all. He comes closer to his followers and tries to understand everyone's capability. Quality or merit of each individual is well recognized by him. Next one is principle of leadership. Democratic administration needs leadership at different levels. The school administrator must possess the qualities of leadership so that others may also follow him. He should inspire, direct, guide, and lead the staff, the students, parents, and the community as well. Principle of democratic philosophy. A set philosophy behind every working ensures its success. A democratic philosophy of the head will make the institution function smoothly and effectively. Next is principle of flexibility. A democratic head of institution believes in the principle of flexibility. He is ever ready to accommodate others in the wider interest of the institution. Next one is principle of optimism. School administrators should be fundamentally optimistic in his outlook and constructive in his policies and procedures. He should have full faith in the efficiency of his program. Next is principle of professional growth. The success of the administrator depends on the efficiency of his colleagues and subordinates. Therefore, he should be sincerely interested in the professional growth of his staff so that they may be able to discharge their duties successfully. Next is principle of relative value. All decisions should be made on the basis of relative value. The goal of the school or the majority of the students should be the most important determining factor. Now we will discuss about functions of educational administration. Educational administration is expected to perform certain functions to achieve the objectives of the organization, like educational administration defines aims and purpose of education. It also frames policies for effective functioning of an organization to achieve predetermined goals. It lays down the structure of the organization. Educational administration prescribes the duties and responsibilities of the positions in the organization. It also prescribes the power and the authority of the position of the organization. Educational administration provides finance and other material resources for its proper functioning at various levels. It plans and operates an effective educational program. Educational administration lays down qualitative and quantitative standards of performance for the personnel. Educational administration provides good professional leadership. It stimulates the workers' efforts and maintains their continuous development. Educational administration evaluates the total outcome in relation to the established policies, aims, and norms. After discussing meaning and concept of educational administration, now we will discuss about the meaning of management. It is the basic integrating process of organizational activity which surrounds our daily life. Management involves many good factors. However, some of them are very experiment and need to be understood in proper perspective in order to make management effective, functional, ever progressing, and strong. In the present era, the emphasis on management is increasing so as to get defined and effective results out of an educational process. So, important functions of management are as such. First one is goal. Some of the goals of education, such as physical, social, emotional, and spiritual development, that is all-round harmonious development of the personality, may be common for all the societies of the world. However, some goals may be different for different nations. Second is resources. Even when it is a fact that school management is to deal with different types of resources, that is human resources, physical resources, abstract resources, financial and community resources like museum, zoo, etc. It needs to be ensured that maximum utilization of these is achieved. These resources, which in themselves don't carry any meaning, are to be made meaningful by the management so as to be useful for the students at their work. Next one is coordination. One very important function which management is to perform in the educational process is to coordinate the functioning of different activities in the institution in such a way that utilization of their functioning provides maximum utility to the students, staff, and management. Next one is counseling. In order to provide beneficial services to the student and community, a dignified control is must. In order to create such a social setup, the management of all the levels should work in a perfect disciplined order. This type of control reflects the type of management. Next one is direction. As the management fixes the aim, which is generally contained in the motto of the institution, which serves as the direction for the institution in good management. The direction should be clear and followed in sportsmanship spirit in the institution. Next one is planning. Planning is one of the formal duties of the management of an institution. Planning is always done in advance in such a way that all things happen in a systematic way. Planning means leading beforehand how things are to be done and why it should be done in that way. In order to make the school activities effective, meaningful and successful, we need effective planning in the following these areas like financing, staffing, resources, motivation, development, supervision and evaluation. Now, next point is monitoring and evaluation. When above factors are kept in view, the monitoring part becomes of greater significance. Poor monitoring leads to the wastage of resources and poor results. If monitoring is of good quality, much of the wastage is controlled and maximum utilization is got out of it. No doubt, supervision is important, but evaluation is more important than it at all the stages of the activity. It is better to carry out periodical evaluation to know the level of success of an activity and to improve upon the weaknesses and drawbacks of the situation. Other benefits also, management improves efficiency and skill. It improves human relations. It decreases type and scope of confusion and increase the confidence of the manager and others who participate in running of institution. Approaches of educational administration, management and governance. First of all, we will discuss social demand approach. This approach was used in Robbins Committee report on higher education in Britain. In India too, this approach is a popular one while opening new schools and colleges in particular. In this approach, there are certain steps involved like to estimate the proportion of students completing school education and are likely to enter into higher education. Second is to estimate how many of these successful school leaving students would actually apply for admission to colleges, to determine how many of the applicants should be given admission to higher education, to determine the length and duration of the study. Thus, the major issue involved in this approach is to forecast future demands for seats, keeping in mind social and educational trends as well as demographic changes. The underlying assumptions in this approach is that expansion on education is beneficial to the economy and thus additional expenditure on education would not create a heavy burden which is unbearable. This approach is more prevalent in those societies which favor traditional cultural values where decisions are taken on the basis of public opinion and in societies where the social environment is generally pessimistic in nature. The approach is based on currently expressed preferences and does not take into account public expenditure on education. Also, it sometimes leads to a mismatch between the output of higher education and the demands of the economy. Second is social justice approach. This approach emphasizes justice to the disadvantaged sections of the society and is based on Article 45 of the Indian Constitution. This approach is aimed at making special provision for the socially, economically, and educationally disadvantaged communities for a longer duration. This includes opening ashram schools for tribal areas, special concessions and scholarships, incentives and relaxation. Next one is rate of returns approach. According to this approach, investment in education should take place in such a way that the returns from the investment are equal to the returns from other kinds of investment of capital. For example, investment in industry. This principle is known as a equi-marginal returns in economics theory and could be extended to educational sector. This approach treats education as an investment in human capital and uses rate of returns as a criterion in allocation of financial resources. The approach implies that if the rate of return is low, expenditure on education should be reduced. However, in reality, it is difficult to apply this approach to education due to problems associated with measuring rate of returns in education. An educated person's earnings or rate of returns depend upon his or her innate intelligence, parental socio-economic status, motivation, and aspirations. Hence, it is not easy to attribute the rate of returns only to education acquired. Hence, this approach is least frequently applied to education. Now, next approach is manpower planning approach. It implies that social system needs educated and trained people with certain well-defined knowledge, attitude, and skills. The demand for such people, that is, manpower, is variable and changes with the technical, economic, and social development. Educational training and development of such people is the human resources development for maintaining and improving the social system and also for the socio-economic and political modernization of a country. Educational system should be as designed so that it should fulfill the country's manpower requirement. It should produce as many educated and trained people of different categories, such as doctors, engineers, teachers, graduates, postgraduates, etc., as are required by the country for its various services. Short production or overproduction of these will be a defect of planning or failure of planning technology. It assumes a greater importance in the field of education as it is regarded as an important factor for economic development of a country. New ideas, new techniques, and new knowledge of production embodied in physical capital determine the rate at which the economy of country as a whole can advance. Every country, therefore, builds up a system of education to fulfill these needs for trained, skilled, and efficient manpower. educational planning in most countries focuses on this perspective. In this method, the general demand and capacity of supply of human resources in different streams and at different levels of the educational sector are estimated. The approach asserts that the system of education produces the right quality of human resources with the desirable knowledge, attitudes, and skills in the right numbers, and thus education is directly linked with the economic development. The application of the manpower planning approach depends on such factors like an appraisal and analysis of the existing employment conditions and the system of education. Planning the system of education using the financial resources which are limited in an optimum way so as to fulfill the demands of the employment sector without experiencing wastage on account of unemployment. Making an appraisal of the number of students enrolled, the number of existing teachers and their qualification, enrollment in teacher education institutions, availability of future teachers, as well as the existing number of school buildings, equipments, infrastructure and other facilities. The requirements of the employers regarding occupational or professional qualifications for employees, their levels of training and abilities should also be assessed. The manpower planning approach takes note of the fact that the teaching profession requires approximately 60% of the highly qualified human resources of a country which competes with the demand for manpower in other economic sectors. A detailed projection of the demand for human resources is difficult due to the uncertainty of productivity trends. Some developed countries such as Norway, France, and Sweden estimate their future manpower needs so as to meet the demands of the economy, whereas others such as Great Britain estimate the numbers to be educated on the basis of students' demands. Next one is intra-educational extrapolation approach. Conceptually, the task of intra-education extrapolation consists of estimating the quantitative implications for the system as a whole. It means setting targets for one particular characteristic of the educational system. Thus, if the targets were to be the achievement of universal primary education up to certain grade level by a certain year, the education planners would explore from the datum the ways in which the supply of teachers, the construction of new buildings, the production of new textbooks and like would need to be scheduled to ensure that the target will be reached. Flow statistics of various kinds become an important tool for this kind of analysis. So, at the end, we can conclude that educational administration is the study and practice of managing the resources, task, and communication involved in running a school. Educational administration is a discipline within the study of education that examines the administrative theory and practice of education in general and educational institution and educator in particular. Educational administration has a vast area of operation ranging from planning to budgeting in an effort to make the educational process purposes and functional. It focuses upon the attitude towards work and adopts practical measures to ensure that the system of work functions efficiently and assist in the achievement of the aims of education, thus benefiting the learners who are the main stakeholders in the educational system. Educational administration is based on different principles like sharing responsibility, principle of equality, principle of freedom, principle of recognition of individual worth, and principle of professional growth. It frames policies and lays down the structure of organization. Educational management improves the efficiency and skill of educational institution and improves human relationship. Thank you.